Well, joining us now in the studio is psychologist Michael Hawton. He's a parenting expert and has done extensive research into adolescent development and behaviour. His most recent book, Engaging Adolescence, also talks about this, and we've got some copies to give away, so keep an eye out on our social media channels. Michael, it's great to have you with us. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
My first question for you is actually a little bit like just a personal interest question.
Yep.
Now, I have some friends who are teachers, and they say that adolescent behaviour and also primary school kids' behaviour is just getting worse and worse, and it's so much worse than it was 10 years ago. Do you think that's true, or do you think that they're just kind of complaining?
No, it is worse.
It is worse,
sorry.
Really?
Well, look, the OECD report that came out months ago is saying that some young people are saying they can't learn at school because the other kids are yelling out in class more.
Oh, gosh.
So there is some reason to believe that that's the case, that behaviour seems to be, in some quarters, getting worse than it has been before.
So why is that?
Hard to know, eh? But the progression of behaviour, of course, can start off as naughty when children are smaller. Then if it doesn't go checked, it becomes naughtier by the time they're, say, 10. And then, you know, if it doesn't become checked, then by the time they're reaching teenage years, it can get more out of control.
So to prepare for the adolescent years, we really need to be starting when they're quite young.
Certainly early intervention is the way to go, you know.
I want to drag it back a little bit. We've had this discussion a number of times on this show. What age group is an adolescent teenager?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Well, in the book I talk about that you could actually start when they're about 10, I reckon, having the conversations, because my book's about how to hold a mediation conversation with your teenage son or daughter, and I'm suggesting maybe 10. But look, their brain doesn't really get fully developed until they're about 24, 25.
Oh, heavens.
And so, you know, the traditional way of thinking about it is 13 to 18, of course, or thereabouts, but we know that either side of that, there still is room to grow.
So for someone with a troubled teenager who is, you know, behaving badly and stuff like that, is it too late? Can they do anything?
No, of course it's not. And really, what we should do is expect children to develop more self-control as they get older. They should be able to exert more self-control from a developmental point of view, because developmentally we know that 10's better than 8, 12's better than 10, if that makes sense. But also there are things that mum and dad can do to help their children reach maturity.
So say I'm pulling my hair out, my daughter's come home, her behaviour at school is really bad, it's just driving me nuts. What can I do at that point?
I will probably not react.
Oh, that's easy.
I mean, I think the thing is that if we want them to exert some self-control, we've got to bring to the party a certain level of self-control.
So monkey see, monkey do.
I've got to be an adult.
we have the fully adult psychological mind, I like to say, and it really is about... parents need a method sometimes. First thing they need to work out, is this a problem? And if it is a problem, what do I do about it? Okay. So the method that goes with saying there is an issue in the first place needs to be worked out.
So what are the biggest mistakes that parents make then? Because I've heard the phrase, it's firm but kind or something?
A warm and firm.
Warm and firm,
yeah. A lot of the research is saying that warm and firm is the way to go. Warm is mum and dad... see me every day, tell me they love me, give me a hug. But firm is important too. Firm.
So how do you do that? Like, I've got two teenage boys, right? And they stop hugging at about 13, or maybe even before then. You know, get to the school gate, don't want to kiss, don't want to hug, don't want to do anything like that. We're boys now, Mum. So yeah, how do you do that warm and firm?
Sure. Do you remember there was a guy years ago called Chapman, I think he was, and he had the five languages.
Love languages.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? And I think there's a teenage version of that as well. And I would have thought, there is.
Okay.
And so the issue is about what's going to be meaningful to them. Mm. It may not be the hug.
No.
But it might be the doing something for them, cooking
or
them
giving
a meal,
them a present.
Or something like that.
But also disciplining in love as well. So, because I'm hearing what you're saying before, the firm bit and the warm bit, but... can you discipline in love? Is that an odd question?
Surely all discipline is in love, though. I mean, I don't know.
No, I don't think it is.
No? Okay.
Well, I think here's the issue. Screaming, yelling and also smacking can create problems because you're making the part of their brain work harder at the back.
Right.
Rather than the part up here.
Mm.
And the part up here is good for premeditating, for making a decision and making a choice, and it can be... it grows developmentally, but also parents can do some things to make this part of your mind work better.
So what sort of things?
It depends on the age of the children, of course.
Okay.
But it is about being clear about your role as a mum and a dad. Mm. You know, what is your role? What's my role? I think it's three things I teach parents. Is it's helping them reach maturity. In other words, helping them get things in proportion. One of the issues I think that's coming up for a lot of teenagers at the moment is that they get things out of proportion. Mm-hmm. The misuse of some words, for example, like, I'm so traumatised. Mm. Well, hang on, you're not traumatised. Mm. You might have needed to study harder for that exam. But that's not trauma.
Yeah.
You know, or I'm depressed. Well, sometimes that's not right. Mm. That's the
You're just sad.
And if it goes on and on, we need to think about it. Mm. But I think parents need to correct their kids sometimes about their misuse of words. The other two jobs are about protecting their wellbeing. Mum and Dad's job is sometimes to make sure the phone stays in the kitchen rather than goes to bed with you at night time.
Yeah, easier said than done.
Because, because you know, my job is to protect your wellbeing, that means I need to make sure if you're my teenage son or daughter, you're going to get eight and a half hours sleep a night, minimum. Mm.
Just really quickly, because I know this is something else you're passionate about, cyberbullying. Mm. It's huge in the media. Everybody's talking about it. Can you give us a really hot tip, other than not taking your phone to the bedroom, on cyberbullying?
The issue, I think, is a strength, a resilience question. If we can help children to self-talk themselves, because most of the bullying starts in the playground, and unfortunately they take it home sometimes on their phone, but it mostly starts in the playground. So sometimes you need to help kids to know when to walk away, when to say self-talk themselves and say, these are not my friends. My friends really are the people that matter, that really matter. My family and my friends are the ones that I should be paying attention to, but these are not my friends. And to have those words, those little sayings sometimes, you know, my mother used to say, for better or for worse, sticks and stones will break your bones, Michael, but names will never hurt you. Yes. Now, it's a saying that's gone out of fashion. But what she was saying is you don't have to pay attention to every little thing that somebody says. You know, if somebody looks at you badly, that's not bullying. They're just looking at you badly.
Yes? What do you do as a parent when it does get to a stage where you can't just say those things and it's okay, you know? Because it is a problem in our society.
Absolutely.
You know?
But the issue is about that we need to do both. We need to help kids with the language that they use to describe it to themselves and to others, but also we need to help them to develop... stop the bullying. Mm. So report the bully, for sure. You know, make sure you can switch the bully off. Like on social media, you can actually... There are tools now to stop... Mm. Yeah? Mm. Stop, block... And help kids develop allies as well, you know, people that they can turn to. Mm-hmm. It might be the girl in year 12, you know, who's on the bus, who's my friend or is known to me, and I sit next to her, if that makes sense. Mm.
Do you have a website or somewhere where we can go and see some of these?
I've got some blogs on this on parentshop.com.au. Okay. So parentshop, all one word, like Europe car, parentshop.com.au. And on it, you'll see a number of blogs there that might help parents.
Excellent. Mm,
very interesting. We kind of talked before about, like, adolescents and toddlers and how, like, we had a topic before about toddler resilience and things like that. Do you talk at all in your book about sort of the transition and how we can prevent bad behaviour as adolescents?
I have another book called Talk Less, Listen More. This one's for teenagers.
Right,
there's another one for littler children. But look, there's some really good books around on this. There's a book called Self-Reg by Stuart Shanker, very good on affect regulation in children. That's the one I would recommend to your viewers.
Mm-hmm. And what sort of tips do you have in that book that we...
He says that parents are what he calls arousal reducers. Their role in helping their children to lower their arousal is incredibly important. Just like parents can traumatise their children on the opposite. So the opposite end of the spectrum of parents who might be abusive and might cause trauma, well, the opposite must be true. In other words, parents can be soothers of their children.
So they can calm them down, bring them down.
Bring them down. He calls it the interbrain. Shanker's good, really great on this stuff. He calls it the interbrain. He says that we can do lots of things to help kids to settle.
Right.
So I've got a 2-year-old. What is the one thing that I can do now to prevent a terrible teenager?
The terrible 15-year-old.
read a book. No. What I can say to you is this, that children rely on our relationship with them. Mm. More than anything, you know. And so at a very young age, they're very, the relationship is the determiner of what happens in their nervous system. Now, I know that sounds spooky, but it's true, that what you can determine what happens in your children's nervous system by what you do, what you say, how you help them lower their arousal, that kind of thing. So there's a lot more to it. But look, warm and firm's your guide. You know, warm and firm means mum and dad care for your child, of course. But firm is being firm about a few things that really matter. And as it turns out, there's not that many rules.
Mm. So you talk about quality time and sort of having that connection. But do you think that technology, obviously technology is something that potentially could be correlated with bad behaviour in adolescence. Do you think that as parents we need to be sort of ourselves stepping away from social media and things like that? Do you think that has an impact on child development, or do you think it's mainly just the fact that, I don't know, they have access to phones and we should prevent that, if that makes sense?
Look, there's some researchers, and I was listening to them the other day, they said pretty well anything you do away from a screen is going to make you happier.
Because I was watching something the other day that says some of the schools are now actually banning phones from the school completely.
Oh, my goodness.
So, and they were interviewing these year 11 and 12 children, and they were saying how different their life is now. They don't have the access to the phones anymore. They're actually outside talking and playing and communicating with people.
Listening in class.
They did some research and they randomly assigned kids to not do Facebook for a week, and those kids over here could do Facebook for a week. Mm. The kids who didn't do Facebook for a week scored happier at the end of the week.
Is that right?
Yeah. Now, wow. I know they use Twitter and Instagram and all that, but they're saying that if you stay away from the social media for 1 week, that's what this research
And that's
was
not
saying.
A lot of time, is it? One week?
I was just thinking, aren't you meant to be 18 and above to start using Facebook or something?
What world do you live in?
Yeah. those don't work.
I think it's about 13.
But I guess it is a good point, because when your mood probably dictates your behaviour quite a bit, I'm assuming, and so to stay away from social media is probably a good thing. Anyway, thank you so much for joining us. We have to cut you off there.
Yeah, sure.
But it's been very interesting.
Thank you.
And thank you to all our fantastic panel for being here today. Now, if you'd like to keep the conversation going on social media, please do so. We'd love to hear your comments. And just remember, there's always a place for you at the table. So we'll see you next time, and God bless. Bye.